Hello and welcome, everyone. My name is Dan Wojcinski. I'm the lead tech artist on Forza Horizon here at Playground Games. I'm super excited to be able to show you a behind-the-scenes look at our content creation pipeline and some of the more interesting technology that powers Forza Horizon 5. But before we dig into some of the tech, I wanted to give you a quick overview of our company and the projects that we work on. Playground Games is a AAA game studio established in 2010. We have two studios located in Leamington Spa, United Kingdom. We employ over 330 employees. We're part of a bigger Xbox Gaming Studios group. We also work very closely together with Tuntent Studios, which we work together with our tools, our cars, share ideas and passion for Forza franchise. In November 2021, last year, we have released Forza Horizon 5. Forza Horizon 5 is an open world racing game set in a diverse landscape of Mexico. Its development began in the middle of 2019 with the aim to release the title on next-gen consoles. In terms of challenges, right from the beginning, we knew we wanted to make a much bigger, richer, and more exciting world than ever before. We also knew we wanted to support a larger pool of platforms than at any point in the past. We wanted to showcase the next-gen power of Xbox Series X, but we also wanted to ensure gamers playing on the older consoles get the best possible visuals they can. Now, setting the game world in a vibrant Mexico, then we had a chance to create some of the most exciting variety of biomes and environments. From sandy dry deserts, through lush jungles, to frosty volcanic mountains, Mexico's breathtaking scenery was an amazing opportunity to raise the visual bar across the entire Forza world. Also, continuing the trend set back in Forza Horizon 4, we wanted to make sure that seasonal change has a visible and meaningful impact on our world. Now, Forza Horizon 5 is a racing game at its core, so we also worked really, really hard to push the quality of our car visuals much further than at any point in the past. We wanted to really showcase the power of next gen. Next up, I'd like to dive a little bit into how we're using Autodesk software at our company, and just a high-level overview of what we're using it for. Now, here at Playground Games, Autodesk software sits at the core of our content pipeline. Some of the notable packages we currently use are 3ds Max. 3ds Max is the most popular package we have. Almost all of the game, all of the content you see in-game has been created inside 3ds Max. Apart from perhaps the roads and terrain. And even if some of the more exotic content hasn't been necessarily authored inside 3ds Max, it still most likely will come through some of that pipeline, as most of our export processes are based inside 3ds Max on our Max script logic. We have a various foliage tools inside 3ds Max written in Max script. We're importing speed tree content, making custom wind data, morph targets, and generating distant billboards. All of our cinematic vehicles that you see in our game, such as the airplane, the train that roams the world, as well as some other showcase vehicles, all of which were created inside 3ds Max. Now, obviously, cars. We have a huge and very rich toolset for creating cars. We work on that toolset together with Tuntent, where we're sharing and adding additional features. Almost entire pipeline is based on 3ds Max and on Max script. Specifically for Forza Horizon 5, we've developed a brand new tool based on Max script, which is responsible for baking bent normals. But we also have a number of other tools, such as an interesting one, which is generates the wiper masks for our sort of weather effects that accumulate on our windscreens. Now, in Forza Horizon 5, we also have a concept of bound finds. This is where the player is able to roam the world and explore and stumble upon those abandoned barns. Inside those barns, you'll be able to find some of the most iconic vehicles in our game. And this is where we're adding a lot of visual storytelling to some of the hand-picked vehicles. All of that extra detail and storytelling is built inside 3ds Max, using a variety of in-house tools. Now, our cinematics, cinematic artists use 3ds Max to set up cameras, blockout shots, as well as preview general flow of the cinematics before exporting them further into our engine and game where the final rendering will take place. And we build a lot of custom MacScript tools that make our artists and level designers' life a lot easier when it comes to creating content. 3ds Max is the primary package we use to export most of the game assets. Apart from the geometry and materials, we also export an absolute ton of custom data that is later consumed by our build pipeline. We have a fair share of automated asset processing jobs, such as billboard baking, hierarchical loads, ambient occlusion, and lightmap texture baking. These jobs run based on MacScript and are very autonomous. We usually run them overnight on our remote build machines. Asset telemetry and stats is another thing we use 3ds Max heavily for. We have a number of tools that give us both granular and general overview of all the 3D content we have in game, where we might have placed it, how many triangles it might contain, what sort of materials we're using, what are the texture. And that information is super valuable to us, especially in the later stages of our production, which this valuable information will help us focus on our optimization processes. Autodesk Maya and Motion Builder is another package that we use very, very often inside our tech anim teams. Now we use Maya mostly for character modeling and animation. We also have various tools inside Maya. A notable one I'd like to pick up is the one that's been written in Python. And it's used by the artists and designers to set up a markup our character customization logic, such as for clothing and accessories. All of the rigging that we might be doing in-house will always be made inside Maya. We have some secondary vehicle animation as well, such as soft tops and suspensions that are animated inside Maya as well. We also have a lot of wildlife in our game. In Forza Horizon 5, we have donkeys, dogs, flamingos, and others. These are all offered inside Maya, rigged up and animated. Now, we quite recently also built the in-house mockup studio here in the studio, where we kind of tightly integrated it together with our motion builder pipeline as well. Another software is Mudbox. But the Mudbox is predominantly used for our terrain sculpting purposes, where terrain team is able to add further detail, refine the definition of the terrain meshes, load the dem data, and further process this terrain before it makes its way into our engine, where it is further worked out by our terrain team using various in-house engine tools. And last but not least is the ShotGrid. Now, ShotGrid is really popular in our asset team. Asset team is using ShotGrid to track handover of various assets between teams, smooth communication with outsourced vendors, as well as tracking various information such as textures, models, where in the world we might be using various models, thumbnails, art briefs, and documentation. We also have numbers of tools that not only read from the ShotGrid database, but also write back to it, such as the AO and Lightmap Baker. This is where our artists can use ShotGrid and mark out various assets for particular techniques of AO baking. They can further customize some of the tool's behavior right inside ShotGrid without ever entering 3ds Max. These jobs run remotely on our build machines and interface with the ShotGrid database using Python API. Excuse me. So next up, I'd like to dig into three sort of handpicked features of our pipeline that I think you'll find interesting. The first one is what we call Forza Materials. Forza Materials are just an extension of native Max materials. They derive from a standard DirectX 11 shader inside 3ds Max. The original implementation was created by talented folks at 1010 Studios. We took that early implementation and built on top of it. Forza Materials explores all of our shader parameters, season swapping logic, as well as provide various debugging functionality, such as component lighting, previews, and others. Forza Materials also allow our in-house tools to interface, read, and write back to various shaders, and also be able to bake various visual information that might be rendered via Forza Materials into individual textures. Now, what happens is that every time we load a max file, a callback is triggered that will find where the asset lives. It'll search for its material properties. It'll parse them and feed them back into our max Forza material. every time we save a max file, all of these sort of shader parameter overrides you might have done and any material changes, or as long as you're working with Forza materials inside Max, will be written back into disk, into the proprietary material file, which can then further be read by our engine and the game. Now, most of our game shaders are authored in our own shader graph editor. They are targeting DirectX 12 and are compiled offline as a part of a game build process. To be able to load them all into Max, we have to convert them to what we call the proxy shaders. This process has been written by our internal rendering team. Proxy shader generator is able to parse through all of the available permutations of our game shaders and output the final resulting DirectX 11 effect file. This effect file can then further be loaded into Max, into our Forza materials, where it can provide the rendering functionality inside the viewport, as well as expose all the properties. The various shader behavior that might depend on some game runtime logic will fall back on some of the default static values, but we also support various shader if devs that allow us to roll out Max-specific behavior where it might be needed. Inside 3ds Max, Forza materials are capable of displaying our own editor material browser. So the artists are not only able to edit the materials, but they can create the new ones, they can delete them, and they can preview the material samples using the engine material browser. Most of this functionality is implemented via maxcrypt.net bindings. This is where we are able to load some of our editor DLLs, and we can lean on some of that already implemented functionality to bring it right into Max in front of our artists. Now, Forza Horizon 5 is using a physically based rendering system. Authoring PBR materials can be tricky. We have to make sure the assets are correctly set up and we're using correct units. The Forza materials provides various debugging functionality to aid the artists in making sure that the assets are using correct values, but it also helps the tech art team to track down and debug and fix various visual issues we might be finding with some of our assets. Some of the debugging functionality we have is previewing albedo. We have a normal map view. This is where we combine both the vertex normal, our normal maps that are authored by our artists. But we also include here our proprietary texture array shader technique that blends multiple normal maps into one. We have an ambient occlusion visualization as well. Here we can visualize both the macro geometry occlusion as well as the texture micro occlusion that's generated by our artists. Some other classic views that we have are gloss visualization, roughness, and metalness. We have a lot more of those debug passes. Depending on what kind of content you're previewing, maybe you're looking at specific foliage assets. We have very bespoke debugging tools inside Max that let us validate and make sure that assets are correctly set up right from the beginning, before they make their way into our game. This ensures that the content that you see in game will be correctly lit, and the visuals will be cohesive. Now, since Forza Horizon 5, we also support seasonal changes to our in-game models. We have to make sure we build that functionality right into Forza materials, since this is where the artists will be modifying our models. And make sure that the artists get the full experience working inside 3ds Max. So inside Max, we have this kind of concept of an active season. So while you're working on a summer, let's say, all of the material changes you'll be making and all of the shader overrides you'll be authoring will be pushed into those seasonal parameters only. All four season shader parameters are loaded in memory and kept track of via custom attributes inside Max. They're ready to be hot swapped at any point whenever the artist chooses so. So whenever an artist wants to work on a winter variant of an asset, they can just switch the season via one of our tools and focus specifically on that season alone. This means that the artist doesn't have to wait and boot our engine or wait and boot our game and update the results, switching between different applications. They can just see that right inside 3ds Max. Now, from the tech point of view, one of the biggest benefits of Forza materials is the script access. We can design and implement various tools inside 3ds Max. That not only have the read access to our shader environment, but can also alter it and create new ones. We can create a set of robust tools inside 3ds Max and put them in front of our artists, knowing well our Forza materials can recreate a believable game shader environment right in its viewport. This can be really powerful for us. One good example of this process is I'm going to talk about next. Uberload Baker. Uberload Baker is another cornerstone feature of our pipeline. It allows us to draw a large amount of complex content right up until the horizon, as per the title of our game. Now, behind the cryptic name of Uberlods hides what other engines on the market call distant hierarchical lods. One of the areas that benefits the most from the Uberlodding in our games are urban areas. The cities and towns of Forza Horizon 5 are made up of thousands of instances of complex high-quality models. In fact, the number of buildings, building instances in our main city of Guanajuato alone exceeded the number of the total building instances in the previous title. That reason is just change of scale. We wanted to make our cities more believable, sprawling, and authentic. But we also change our workflows where our urban areas are created in a lot more modular way nowadays. This means we mix and match various assets and induce more variety into our content via instance attributes. This means that we can spend less authoring time on the unique assets, and we get more freedom on assembling our environments. But it also comes at the cost of inflated number of instances. To help with processing such large amounts of data, we've designed three tiers of our Uberlods in our game engine. We have tier one. But tier one of Uberlods is the one you see to the nearest of the camera. This tier of Uberlods is responsible for merging instances. Its job is to scan through instances and simply clump them together. Now, the tier number two, we'll be able to see in the mid-distance. This is where we're not only merging various instances, but we further do geometry reduction. This reduction is done via our Simpligan plugin inside 3ds Max. This is where we can use the Simpligan API inside our Max script and configure various properties, create a correct result that matches our game visuals. Now, tier number three is the last tier you'll be able to see. This is where we're also doing the instance merging and geometry reduction. We also do what we call projection-baked textures. Now, what is projection-baked textures, you may think? This is where we are kind of leaning on the Forza material functionality inside 3ds Max, and we are able to bake the high-quality shader information of the asset's visual into sets of individual textures. These textures later can be mapped and projected onto the lower-quality optimized version of the Uberlod. How does that work behind the scenes, and how does 3ds Max fit into all of this? We wrote a system that scans through all of our instances of a given content type. Here, I'd like to show you what our Guanajuato city alone looks like in terms of building instances. As you can see, it is very, very dense, and there's thousands of instances hiding in here. What the process is doing is going through every Uberlod cell and is allocating various building instances into individual cells. This sort of clustering mechanism is controlled via various properties that are configurable via our XML custom config files. It can be read inside Max and further adjusted at the tool's time. Now, you'll also notice that some of those clusters contain a very little amount of instances, while the clusters in the middle of the city contain a fairly dense amount of them. So what we do in here is that if we find that one of our given clusters doesn't contain enough instances, we tend to look for the neighboring cells and see if we can merge them together. This is to ensure the batching is optimal, the content is as lean as possible. Now, once we generate all this cluster information, we've gathered all of the data, we put it together into a file and write it into disk. Some of the notable information that we track at this point is instance GUIDs, parent cluster GUIDs. This is so that we can map which instances belong to which cluster. We also track model references, instance transform, instance unique attributes, module projection, as well as keeping track of the date the asset's been modified last. This is to make sure that we're only rebaking the clusters that are absolutely needed, and we aren't spending valuable time rebaking clusters that won't really change the visuals of the game. So what happens next is we're going to be iterating through all of these clusters that we've generated. We're going to be loading them into our Max session. All of the instance objects associated with a given cluster will be loaded into 3ds Max. We're going to be retargeting our transforms between our game coordinate system and Max, as well as loading and populating all of those Forza material attributes I've mentioned earlier. Here you can see the distribution of unique assets in an average city cluster. Unique meshes have been given a random color, but this cluster is 50 square meters in size and contains around 50 instances on average. This is just one of the city clusters that you may see. Now, any repeating unique meshes that might be happening in the same cluster will be collapsed together to provide a more optimized content and reduce the draw call count per cluster. Next up, we have a choice of options, depending on which tier of overloads we're making. I wanted to show you the last tier as it is the most complex and challenging one. Here I have loaded four distant clusters. You can see that their average triangle count is just under 30,000 triangles. Now, after the operation of baking the overload, we have managed to optimize this geometry by more than 50%, down to just around 13,000 triangles. We have further stripped any expensive shaders, and instead of using complex set of textures, we're now using simplified projection baked texture, which are wrapped onto the lower quality mesh. Now, this process gives us a huge performance saving, especially in a distance, but it comes at the quality cost. This is why we also have to make sure that we choose the distances at which time you'll be able to see those overloads very carefully. Make sure that the transition between a high quality content and a lower quality content is as minimal as possible. I've also mentioned earlier that we try to sort of induce a variety into our streets and urban areas using instance attributes. We use individual instance attributes to control various visual effects, such as tint variation, emissive and light map offset, as well as the night light switch. This is to make sure that when you're driving through night, the entire city uniformly won't decide to switch on the lights inside the house, to make sure that the emissiveness of this light is varying in degree, and to make sure that tinting is also wide in variety. Now, since we're going to be merging all of these instances together into clusters, we're going to be only be able to have one set of instance properties per cluster alone. This means that we can no longer really control these visual effects using those properties. We have to be clever in terms of how do we use them. But the Uberlot system itself, it'll bake all of the instance properties into our vertex colors, as well as various texture ports. We'll have to overcome various challenges as the vertex colors, for instance, precision is a lot lower than our instance property precision in individual value. The resulting clusters will have to use a different variety of our shader to produce the same visual results, but look for those inputs in different areas. I wanted to also show you what those textures look like when they're fully baked. You can see we've got an albedo, a light map, as well as an emissive. These textures are 2K in size, but they could be much higher if you'd like, as long as you're happy with the longer bake times, obviously. All of the packing and image generation is done in, say, 3ds Max. Now, the actual resolution of the textures in game will vary depending on the platform that we're playing. So if we're playing on a top spec Xbox Series X, we'll be using the highest resolution textures available. However, if we're playing on an older set of consoles, the game will be using downsampled results. Now, these textures belong to just one of many overload clusters. For the city alone, we've produced over 50 of them. And if we look at the whole world, we have around 150 of them. These are the tier three of our overloads. On the other hand, if we look at the tier one clusters, which are much, much smaller in size, around the whole of our world, we generate about 1,500 of them. This bake process is fully automated and runs on remote build machines. In the later stages of the project, we end up regenerating them weekly. But the number of bakes we're going to be producing depends largely on the amount of changes that's being still introduced to the world. I wanted to show you what the result of the clustering looks like. Here you can see just how granular the building instances might be, especially on those buildings right next to the roads. You can see they're made up of individual submeshes, which generates a really large amount of instances. Here you can see the early results of our tier one clustering. This is where the buildings now are merged into individual groups. We've reduced the number of instances greatly while still maintaining the same kind of visual density in the urban area. Now, these clusters are, as I've mentioned, 50 meters squared in size, but that size is easily configurable. And you may find that in different environments, we might be using different cluster sizes depending on what kind of performance challenges we might be facing. Now, depending on the target platform, we might be drawing them between 250 meters and 350 meters. Visually in game, we won't be able to tell the difference whenever we switch between a normal instance object to our clustered result. Now, the last one I wanted to show you here is what those Uberlot looks like for the sort of most distant content. This is the tier three. This is where you can see the clusters are much bigger in size, which means we've got a lot less geometry budget to play with. This is where we further quite aggressively optimize the geometry. And you can already begin to start noticing various artifacting and shape. But at the distances that you'll be able to see this, which is past 2 kilometers, you won't really be able to notice the changes. You'll be looking at the city as a whole formation of buildings rather than individual shapes. Now the cities and urban areas, they're not the only place where we use our Uberlots. Another large visual area that benefits from our Uberlot system is geology. In Forza Horizon 5, we have some rich and expensive content here, such as canyons, volcanoes, and mountains. Each one area in itself is a challenge to draw for a long distance, to a quality we aim for. And it is the Uberlot system that really allows us to draw the content for just as long as we'd like. Our geology Uberlots use exactly the same system as our urban areas. But this is where we lean on some of that customizability I've mentioned. The config files for the geology will look a lot different than from the buildings. As one of the biggest differences between geology and urban areas, that the density of mesh is a lot greater when it comes to geology. So we have to think a little bit differently in terms of how to approach this problem. I wanted to show you a quick video. This is where you can see that canyon area looks like in game. Our geology team has done an incredible job replicating those visuals in game. You can see there's a fair amount of details up close, but you can also tell that details maintained throughout the distance. Our geology visuals are also created via modular workflows, where we kind of mix and match various geology assets. This produces a really believable and great result, comes at the performance cost. I wanted to show you the biggest difference between the Uberlot, as I've mentioned, between the Uberlots of a geology and urban areas is just the density of mesh. I've loaded up an average cluster that we've made for our geology. You can see that the top spec is node 0. This is where we've got just around 16,000 of triangles. For our geology to be able to be drawn for such long distances, we have to really work hard to bring back the level of detail as low as possible. Or a lot four, which is made up of 3,000 triangles. And we have to also be really careful when we do this. We employ various techniques, such as dithering, to hide a transition between a high-quality mesh and the lower-quality mesh. Finally, our Mexican pyramid temples. Those are authored in a very modular way, just like the real pyramids, made up of individual blocks that are assembled together by our asset team and composition team into the final temple visuals. Again, this is a great work for our artists and very natural for them as well. We can create some really believable pyramids and temples. But again, it comes at the cost of just a huge number of instances that we have to deal with. This is another area that Uberlot really comes in handy to save the day. I wanted to show you a quick comparison. You can see on the left is the temple that's been assembled by our artists. It's made up of many individual instances, reducing the final image. On the right, we have the results of the clustering of Uberlots. It very closely follows in shape and visuals, but you can also see it's only been made up of 4 individual instances. And that pretty much wraps it up for the Uberlot itself. There's another technology I'd like to talk about next, and that's billboard rendering. We have a huge amount of unique foliage content in our game, such as plants, bushes, and trees. Sprawling vistas full of foliage is something that Forza Horizon games have always been known for. Our talented foliage team produces some of the most beautiful looking realistic foliage models. Unfortunately, as you can imagine, that beauty comes at the price of performance. You have to find some clever solutions that will let us draw such a large number of high quality models for a very long distance. As you can see from that lovely video, in Forza Horizon 5, we have large amounts of foliage content. I think we've sort of broken all of the records we've had internally in terms of just the pure amount of instances and unique assets. When it comes to tree specimens alone, we've produced over hundreds of unique models. It's a very similar number for our bushes and ground cover. But ground cover in Forza Pipeline comprises of both vegetation such as grasslands, plants, and crops. We've also scattered millions of instances across our world. We have a varying distances depending on a size of a tree that you'll be able to see, as well as its specimen, and maybe how important it is. On average, our trees are drawn between 2 and 4 kilometers. But for some of the trees that you can see, especially on the mountain peaks and crests, some of those will be drawn for even as long as 10 kilometers. Now, to be able to achieve this, we have to transition our foliage to what we call billboards. A billboard renderer is a 3ds Max-based tool that allows us to bake high-quality model information onto atlas texture that can then be mapped into individual billboard geometry. Each of our foliage models will be loaded into 3ds Max and will be rendering its visual in slices of 8 that form the horizontal impostors. We use V-Ray inside 3ds Max, render out a number of render targets, such as albedo, masks. Well, masks are quite interesting. They comprise of both the trunk and canopy mask. This is where you can distinguish between those two elements, and that information can be fed later into our shader to produce different lighting effects. We also packed some other information into our masks, such as transmission, gloss, and tint. We also render out ambient occlusion. This ambient occlusion pass contains both the speech tree generated geometry occlusion, as well as the micro occlusion that's been generated by producing textures in our foliage team. And we also bake a fairly unique 3-point bake lighting system. This is where you can see we're rendering out 3 individual light sources separately into individual textures. That information can then further be combined and interpolated at runtime, or depending on the light source, rotation of the tree, time of the day, those 3 passes will be combined and blended to produce the final result. Each of these separate render passes is later stitched and packed into 3 separate textures. For Forza Horizon 5, we've produced 3 atlas sets that would contain all of our unique models, and we further do individual bakes for each season. The numbers are also very similar to other content types. So we've got our billboards as well baked for our bushes, as well as our plants. These textures are later exported in our in-house texture compiler. This is again, thanks to MaxScript.NET bindings, we're able to load our engine functionality and lean on some of that great work that's been done by our tools department. And the billboards themselves, they've got 3 levels of detail. Now, Lot 0 is the top spec. This is the one you see the closest to the camera. This is where we're using the most expensive version of the shader to produce the best results that are the closest to the high quality mesh. Lot 1 is the billboard you see in the distance. This is where we have to start looking at our per pixel cost and start reducing some of the shader features. Some of the shader features we drop at this stage are smooth blending in between billboard frames, as well as alpha to coverage. Now, LUT 2 is a LUT that uses the very long distances. This is a new type of LUT that we've only added recently for Forza Horizon 5. This is where we've noticed, after placing those billions of instances of trees in our game, the numbers of triangles has been increasing, especially at the very long distances. So we had to think really hard in terms of how we can reduce the triangle density. We can see that we've decided to optimize the billboard quad into an actual individual triangle. Now, this is a saving of just 1 triangle, but when you're drawing thousands of instances, it really does add up. I wanted to show you what the individual trees look like when you start mapping that atlas information into individual models. You can see that we're sort of taking a little bit of a gamble when it comes to LUT 2. And for this particular tree specimen, we aren't really seeing any problems, right? The tree is clearly visible, and we can fairly easily read its shape. However, not all tree specimens are of kind of that particular shape. Now, especially if we start looking at pines or your classic sort of Christmas tree, where the wider branches stay at the bottom of the trunk. This is where you'd start losing some of that information because there just isn't enough geometry information to map that image onto. And this was one of the challenges we really started to looking hard here in our tech team. But what we've noticed after a fair amount of testing is that at the distances that we'll be seeing those, and that's just about a kilometer and a half, you aren't really looking at trees in terms of individual assets or models or shapes. You're reading this kind of large tree foliage formations. And quite often, more often than not, those missing elements actually get occluded really quickly, especially because they're at the bottom of the tree. I wanted to show you what this billboard content looks like in a game. All of those mountains you see in the distance, they're covered with trees that are made up of billboards. You can see there's a fair amount of detail in the canopy. We've got some really nice lighting response on those. And in general, the vista blends quite well with the nearby woodland area. Those billboards also respond to the kind of general lighting in the scene. While they might not be as normal maps, the frequent lighting is just as good for them to be able to be blended into the rest of the scene. As I've mentioned, Forza Horizon games have always been known for these kind of huge or aspiring vistas. And foliage always plays a really large role in those shots. And the Billboard Manager is one of those tools that really helps us reach for those kind of visual goals we always struggle to implement. It's one of those key technologies here in the studio that really lets us paint the world the way we'd like. And that's everything when it comes to my tech. I'm really hoping that you found this talk enjoyable and you found some insightful technology here. I'll be happy to answer any of your questions in the following Q&A session. Thank you.
All right. Hi, everyone. I hope you enjoyed that terrific presentation by Dan from Playground Games, who honestly kicked off Vision Series with the bang. I'm Kelly Ningwan, a marketing manager here at Autodesk, and I'm super stoked to be moderating this Q&A session with Dan. But before we get into it, I just want to remind everyone, it's not too late to get your questions in, so be sure to hit that Q&A button and ask him all of your burning Forza Horizon 5 or content creation related questions. But let's get into it. So Dan, we had a couple of questions come in about game engine. The first one that came in is, what are your primary export formats for your tools into your engine?
Mm-hmm. Great question. We have proprietary formats that we use. So we've actually built our own model compiler that's based on 3ds Max SDK that is able to scan through to the geometry information and all the material information I've mentioned. And it exports our own proprietary binary model information that is then consumed by our engine. Similar kind of story happens to our textures. Our textures, the source textures we work with are TIFFs, but they are fed into our own custom texture compiler that will build them into our own kind of proprietary binary information.
Sweet. And then how do you export environments from 3ds Max to your game engine to Forza Horizon?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Great stuff. So obviously we have our own custom, as I've mentioned, proprietary engine. We've built this sort of Max export pipeline based on Max script. That pipeline is listening to various callbacks during every time an artist begins to save their content. It also is invoked every time we build our maps. That happens nightly. That mechanism will parse the model information and it'll figure out what kind of asset it is. Is it a car? Is it a building? Or is it maybe a prop? And based on some of that contextual information, it will export various data. That data will be some of the, I guess, common bits of pieces, such as geometry information and material. But if it's a cinematic asset, it'll also export animation, bone data, and all of that stuff. All of that data that's exported from Max will live on our own, what we call an export cache. That information is stored on our own servers and it will be picked up every time we decide to build a fresh version of the game.
Sweet.
Hope that answered the question.
Sweet. So let's switch gears a little bit here. There's one question. So regarding that switching of materials, everything is within on asset work file and will be switched by a script inside 3ds Max. Does that allow working on different seasonal materials by multiple artists, or is that something that's handled on your side? If so, how?
Mm-hmm. Great question. That's correct. Everything is stored on, I guess, on the asset. We have that custom material file that we store all of the material information of the asset that includes the seasonal overrides that we have. No, you won't really be able to have two separate artists working on the same asset, at least at this point in time, simply because that file is still single file associated with that model. You can make those individual changes, but you can't have two people working on the same file because they both have to check this out, and it could create potential conflicts. I think that's about it.
Cool. Next question. How do you ensure global changes to visual systems such as seasons or AO settings don't introduce bugs into the content library? How did the team efficiently QA content or track what content needed to be reviewed when a system like Seasons was updated?
Great question. I guess the short answer is loads of reviews and loads of testing. The longer answer to this is we have some global control over our lighting information, such as the contribution of transmissive lighting, the contribution of AO and indirect bounce lighting and other things. These properties can be configurable for different seasons, right? So you can achieve a slightly different lighting in different seasons. This means that, yes, it's very easy to introduce a potentially global change, but we're also on the lookout. So when changes like this are made, there is a mechanism that we use to sign this off, to review the results. Later, we'll pass this information to our QA teams, who will be on a particular lookout, looking at those areas, seeing if anything maybe looks a little bit different than they expect. They get our kind of requirements and what to look out for. And again, loads of reviews, especially later in the project. We end up having reviewing the game daily, looking at various seasons. And the seasons themselves provide their own challenge. So we've actually built this custom Xbox rig in one of our rooms, where we have four individual consoles tied together, both receiving your controller information, but each one rendering different seasonal information. So while you'll be driving your car in, let's say, the summer Xbox, the winter Xbox will be driving the car in exactly the same manner. It'll be replicating those controls. So you'll be able to see exactly what that content looks like in every season we support. It's one of the crucial bits of, I guess, tech there in terms of QAing or doing a pass on some of those global changes that we do make.
Very cool. Sweet. So Dan, obviously you spoke a lot about Autodesk tools that are used in the game. Someone wanted to know, do you use Adobe Substance in your workflow?
Mm-hmm. Yes, we use the Substance Designer. We use the Substance Painter for all sorts of content, very heavy painter on the character work there. We use the Substance very heavily in our terrain pipeline for generating a lot of textures. I'm sure it's used across the assets in various areas. We have our own sort of library of Substance materials and other bits and pieces that we share. And definitely use it, and definitely looking out forward. How could we use it more? And what else is there in store for us in the future?
Well, someone just asked, are you also integrating maybe ZBrush in your pipeline as well?
Correct. Yes, we use the ZBrush. We also use Mattbox, as I've mentioned. Yeah. You'll find different artists preferring different packages or focusing being strong in particular packages. We use ZBrush as well as Moodbox for adding some further details to our characters, especially organic content. But even things for prototyping, like prototyping geology elements and terrain as well, it's very useful tools.
Cool. Cool. Here's another question. What benefit did the three-point lighting system have on vegetation billboards compared to a technique like baking a series of depth maps for each tree, a technique that's been used for, octahedral impostors?
Mm-hmm. I'm not too familiar with the depth technique there. I can definitely answer in terms of, let's say, our first pass of the billboards. So the initial implementation of the billboard rendering was actually using normal mapping, where we were rendering individual normal information from the model, mapping that onto the atlas plane, and then feeding that information into our shader. But we've obviously noticed normal information, while maybe not expensive on its own, it does all add up, especially for objects in the distance. Three-point lighting, essentially, the best way to think about the three-point lighting is that you're baking the contribution of angles. So every pixel that we write to that three-point lighting texture represents the angle strength of that given point and the direction of the light. And so that means that we can skip that process of computing that information, which is something you'd have to do when you use the normal map in a shader. You have to compute the normal and the light vector dot product. This can be skipped and we can just interpolate in between the three. Now, this means we're slightly bypassing the physical aspect of maybe how the lighting behaves, but especially at the distances and looking at the foliage as a formation really in the distance, we've noticed that we can save a lot of compute performance there and still get pretty decent results. And yes, we do use our impostor system. So we don't use the one I guess you've mentioned, but we have a horizontal impostor. So we don't necessarily have to look at our trees from the top because we rarely really have a landscape that would allow you to really look far down. You're in a car, you're sort of looking ahead at what's in mm-hmm. front of you rather than looking over the ledge. So that also means we don't have to render so many frames to cover the entire sphere of the view of the model. We can just focus on the sort of lateral axis of the model and only bake the bits information that we're actually going to benefit from.
Cool, thanks. Another question just popped in. Do you have any generalists on your team that maybe perhaps write their own scripts as well as model or texture assets?
Not specifically on a tech art team. We definitely have, I guess the games, AAA games are a complex piece nowadays. Things are only becoming more and more complex. Mm-hmm. And so you can even see that on various applications, such as Substance is a fairly technical application that artists are really utilizing these days, and you've got various procedural pipelines. Now, we have artists that actually do double in scripting these days. They sometimes come up to us, to our team, and saying, hey, Dan, I've worked on this recently, and this is really cool. You know, maybe we should have a look at this, and we'll look at that stuff, seeing how we could maybe integrate this into our tool set. That definitely happens. In terms of texturing, modeling on a tech team, every now and then we get a little chance to do something visual and we do enjoy it, to be able to actually put something visual in game and have it there. But usually we stick to our guns sort of thing and do the technical bits.
Sweet. Well, I guess as a follow-up to that question, obviously this session is literally called Exploring Next Gen Content Creation Pipeline. Mm-hmm. How do you see your content creation pipeline evolving in the future?
Mm-hmm. Great question. I think as I've mentioned, the complexity is one of the challenges. We all want to build a bigger world, and not just bigger in scale, but bigger in detail. We want to make them more believable. That sort of means a lot of hoops and challenges awaiting artists creating the content, making sure they're making the right decision. So I think the pipeline will definitely evolve to be more flexible, taking away some of the maybe challenging technical decisions that sometimes artists is forced to make to give them more control over the visual, I guess, aspect of content creation. So more flexibility, more user-friendly interface, the ability to make wide global changes for the entire map and provide some guidance for those changes where maybe various recipes or procedural kind of rules that can be applied to do particular things in our environment. I think that's probably the direction we're going to move, but who knows what's in store for us. Technology moves in different directions. Even things like AI, right? The machine learning is really gaining traction in the game industry. We're also keen on looking at that area and seeing how maybe we should leverage this this kind of area in our tools. There's a lot of applications that could be made there using the AI. Procedural pipeline is another pipeline that's really taking off nowadays. Forza Horizon 5 had it was the first project we ran with our own procedural creation system that generates roads and terrain. We'll be looking at that pipeline as well, seeing how we can further improve this and what else we might be missing. There's a lot of interesting feedback there after finishing a project of this scale where you see some of the new potentials that we could explore.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure like something like procedural workflows will really help for not just terrains, but you're talking about in your presentation, like the foliage and like, you know, the environments. I think that'll really benefit.
Exactly. Yeah. Definitely. It's this this challenge nowadays of much bigger words, much more detailed worlds. It means we need to be able to control a huge amount of parameters by a fairly small number of controls, because otherwise it's not just really manageable for the artist. And if you take that away from the artist and just let the machine do all the thinking, you're not going to end up with the kind of results that we're looking to get.
Mm-hmm. And someone here wrote, this is not a question, they just want us to say that it's a great game from a visual and gameplay perspective. So
great stuff. Really, really pleased to hear this. I'm really happy you've enjoyed it.
Sweet.
Thank you.
We have a few minutes left. I think we have some time for maybe one or two more questions. Someone here is asking, did your team use or evaluate Max creation graphs in 3ds Max? Don't know if you're familiar with it.
I suspect the problem is, let me give you a quick story about our Max usage. When we began working on a Forza Horizon 5, as I've mentioned, that was middle late 2019. We were running with Max 2018 version there, and we make a pretty hard rule of not upgrading, not making big upgrades during the production, in order to not interfere with the art processes and produce more challenges. That means we're still quite actually behind in our Max version now. Now it's actually a perfect time for us to look at upgrading, and we're actually in a process right now of evaluating the latest Max package. I suspect the creation graph is probably not something I was there maybe in 2018, or I might be wrong, but yes, I haven't really heard about this. I don't think I can really answer.
No worries. Awesome. I'll ask you maybe one more question. What was the challenge you feel the most proud of overcoming during the development of Forza Horizon 5?
Mm-hmm. Great question. I'll sort of answer it in two parts. From a technical point of view, the sheer number of platforms that we had to support meant a tremendous challenge for us, right? We've had our next-gen Xbox Series X and S. We wanted to still support all of the Xbox Ones. And we were shipping a Windows PC with a numerous possibilities of configurations. So we were really aiming to deliver a next-gen experience, but we also needed to really be smart about scaling down the visual quality to meet the other platforms. And we've had to put a lot of effort and time to create a technology that is allowing us to do this. And then hearing on the release of the game, how people, I know a few of my friends mentioned it was the best next-gen experience for them at the time. And that was really nice to hear. Nice to hear that felt like we've ticked that box that we really were aiming for. And artistically, recreating Mexico was a big challenge. It was an incredibly vibrant location with so many possibilities. And again, hearing how excited people were exploring that and posting their videos online made it all worth it in the end. And all that extra effort paid off.
Yeah, I'm sure that seeing, you know, fans just loving something that you put so much heart in is really a great feeling. But thank you, Dan. Thank you so much. I think I'll wrap things up because we're almost at time. Thank you for being part of our vision series, and thank you for everyone for watching. And also, I want to say big congrats to the Playground Games team for creating such a fantastic game. But for now, thanks.
Thank you so much, Kelly. And thank you. Thanks to the audience as well. I hope you found it interesting and entertaining. And it's been a pleasure being able to show you some of the cool bits we've been up to recently.
Thanks, everyone.